rock musician performs, an audience responds. A process repeated a million times in a thousand rock concerts. A very few are special, like this one. Sometimes there's a magic moment when concert becomes theater, when audience and performer become one. This is the record of that moment, as told by the men who made it, Creedence Clearwater Revival.
It has an elating effect on you. It makes you feel good. Therefore, you, like, I love music. I consider it a good thing. I don't love it because I think it's good. I just love it.
Like, it's the fear of, like, blowing it and the excitement of being able to do it at the same time.
If we're all working together, boom, you know, it's just fabulous, and everybody's turned on.
If you do turn them on, you really feel rewarded, and that's really the reward. That's the only reward that counts, I think.
And in concert, this is Creedence Clearwater Revival.
In the world, because they speak everybody's language. Creedence Clearwater Revival.
Creedence Clearwater had come home to Oakland, California, and 14,000 fans were there to welcome them back. This was a special night, and they knew it. The focus was on the 24-year-old leader of Creedence, John Fogerty. For tonight was the culmination of an 11-year struggle for himself and the group. 24-year-old drummer Doug Clifford, 24-year-old bassist Stu Cook, and John's brother Tom Fogerty, rhythm guitarist, age 27. They had left Oakland as unknowns and returned as one of the most influential groups in rock music. Now they would have 56 minutes to work their special kind of magic.
Thank you.
John Fogerty, lead singer, guitarist, songwriter, arranger, producer, and business manager. Fogerty's success is the payoff to a young boy's fantasy. A fantasy of a world filled with men who sang the blues. Greats like Howlin' Wolf and Muddy Waters, who sang of hard times and bad times and places far removed from the suburbs of the Oakland Bay. For 9 of his 11 years in music, John Fogerty held the dream of a world he'd never seen, a combination of southern rock and roll and blues that he has consciously made part of his image. In 1959, the group meets for the first time as the Blue Velvets. The image changes, as does the name. The Four Winds, the Visions, the Gollywogs. But fortunes stay virtually the same. They remain unknowns. In 1967, Creedence Clearwater Revival is born. They continue to work and live in the East Bay area. A warehouse in industrial Berkeley becomes the arena in which they gather 8 hours a day to strive for the elusive mastery of their instruments and weld together their talents in that very special sound that is Creedence Clearwater Revival.
Start too fast. Well, I don't know if in person.
Oh, just
yeah, relax a little more instead of you know, driving like that, because the record isn't quite a driving thing. It's more a relaxed shuffle almost, you know. I guess all the strings, it's getting your fingers to go back where they ought to. Even though your head knows what the note is, you might get, you know, I get caught in the wrong position a lot of time.
Thank you.
And it's like learning how to drive a stick after an automatic, you know.
Yeah.
You're nice to know you're vulnerable, John.
It makes my day a lot better.
Okay.
Most of my struggles were mental. My old man wasn't around when I wanted an old man, you know. My mother was a teacher who was supposedly making a good living. She really didn't get involved in my life. And when she would, it would be the times when I was finally to the point where I said, don't get involved with me. I don't want you anyway. I've been doing it on my own for so long. Leave me alone. It's that kind of thing. Maybe it's because I've made it now and I don't have to worry about it. But until a week before our first hit record, it was still, you know, right there in the back of my mind. I mean, it was like, I may never get out.
I wanted a drum set. Both my parents worked.
So they gave me an opportunity to get a job. I worked every weekend, and I was a gardener and the maid, you know, and I did the dishes during the week. And that's how I got my bread for the, you know, for the thing. They didn't have to do that. Like, they could have just said, look, we're working, you work too.
You're going to try this just for a year, aren't you? Then after that, you know, you'll go back. I said, yeah, Dad, just, you know, just let me try it a little bit, you know, get out on my own. He says, I'll send, you know, look, if you go to law school, man, I'll send you to Europe for a year, you know, all on me, you know, whatever. I said, sure. It just, all those, he tried to buy me back into the thing. And now, the whole thing has changed because we got him working for us.
Pressure on John, and there's a lot of pressure, I guess, on all of us, because I want to live up to what John expects of me.
We want to be better maybe in this concert than we've ever been, and hopefully because we've practiced a lot and we have improved anyway, you know, just evolving as musicians, that it will be the best concert we've ever played. We want that to happen. But at the same time, the show itself is very important to me also.
My biggest fear, man, if these people are going to boo us off, you know, you're not sacred. If you ain't making it, the first cat's going to, you know, everyone will think it like the emperor wears no clothes. Finally, some cat will go, boo, and pretty soon the whole place will just tear you to pieces, you know. But I don't care who you are. When you're really into your music, when you're really excited about it and about pleasing them, they know it, and they let you know, too.
Backstage, Saturday night, 10 o'clock. Tonight they are more than musicians. They are showmen who have put together their first concert, having chosen and booked the acts, assuming total artistic control. It is the culmination of a week filled with the strain of promotion and the humor of countless personal appearances.
One of them said to me, should I get his or not? Is he just here to see them or is he one of them?
Ah, you don't know your heroes, lady.
You don't need a pin there, just hang around. But if you got a nickel, won't you lay your money down? Over on the corner, there's the happy noise. People come from all around to watch the magic boy. Down on the corner, out in...
Publications that predicted their demise now feature their success. In addition, they are now the sometimes uncomfortable stars of Top 40 radio.
Tonight, our special guests, Creedence Clearwater Revival, a fantastic bunch of fellows they are. If you'd like to talk to them on the telephone, our action line is open at 478-3240. If you're calling from San Jose, 575-5540. Tell you what, why don't we have one of the members here... Okay, why don't you go ahead and give us a commercial, okay?
Sure.
Okay.
Pets need good homes, too. Pets Unlimited, 3170 Sacramento Street, San Francisco. The pet you want is waiting to be adopted.
Oh, Tom hi. Campbell at 28 minutes past 8 of KY, bridal fair time. And John, if I can get you over here for a second, would you do me a favor? I'd like you to draw a name out of the finalists that we put in the little hopper here for the top 1,000 Golden Gateways. Oh, would you do that for me for a second? Just reach in, pull out a name for me. Just reach in. You got a name?
Okay.
Okay. John Fogarty has just drawn a name, and let's see whose name is on here. Gwen Wafer, 162 South 17th Avenue, Richmond, California. Gwen, you have just won the top 1,000 Golden Gateways and the tape recording to play them on from KYA. Thank you so much, and you ought to thank John Fogarty. He drew your name tonight.
John, now that you've been across the nation, you've seen many different states, you've seen hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people, you have real success in the music world. What do you think of pickles and how they taste?
I don't like them.
Is there any particular type of pickle you don't like?
Dill.
Dill pickles? Is there any real reason you hate those?
They're not kosher.
Thank you very much. I'm glad we got this settled. It's just another exclusive here on the station.
Real people, Creedence Clearwater Revival. I'm talking none other than John, Tom the Scorpio, Stu, and of course the Doug. Four magnificent people.
I find myself continually asking myself, why? Why is that guy saying that? And then telling myself, oh, I forget, I'm a star. And he thinks I'll act a certain way. Right, react is a much better word.
And I wish you success. I don't even have the wish you successful this weekend. It's going to be a gas of a concert. And just continued success to a bunch of really wonderful guys.
Oh, yes. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Groovy.
You want to kidnap her, Tom?
Oh, kidnap me.
Okay, we're ready.
We're
ready. Is Cosmo here? Where's Cosmo?
Oh, kidnap
me. Cosmo!
Please kidnap me.
I'm sorry, but it's way out of
Cosmo
our control.
Cosmo was here. I thought I was the last one out.
I wanted to find out
she
if,
wants
like...
to be kidnapped.
I wanted to find out if, like, you know, like,
we were real?
Yes.
And what did you find out?
I think we are. There's one thing you have to understand, that when you're on any kind of media, that part is real.
Well, then why don't you kidnap me so I can find out?
Back to that again.
Okay. If you can't dig it, then take this and enjoy it.
Well, oh, but it's open and we can't.
I think it would do you more good than us.
Yeah.
We don't drink. We're not on that trip.
Oh,
who's
man.
Who's on our trip?
It's been, like...
Love and peace is.
Eva and all the chicks won't understand. All
what
the,
chick? We don't have...
All the groovy chicks.
You're the only one that's...
Boy, that's a real trip.
Cosmo!
On Friday night, there's a jam session with the people who created the Memphis Sound, Booker T and the MGs, led by the legendary Booker T. Jones. The session represents a summit meeting of men who had never met. So between John Fogarty and guitarist Steve Cropper, there's a testing of ideas to confirm a mutual admiration. We'll be right back. Booker T and the MGs jam with Creedence. A preview of technical perfection and musical excitement that Creedence will share on Saturday night with 14,000 other fans. We'll be right back.
I said, don't look now, it ain't you or me. It was a challenge, really, to take a look at yourself. And most of us refuse to get involved with the dirty work of humanity. Since I realize I don't have any answers for it, the best thing I can do is at least point it out and say, there it is. Maybe someone else will hear the song and say, wow, that's something that needs to be taken care of.
Don't look now, someone's done your praying.
KFRC is proud to present the words, music, and thoughts of Creedence Clearwater Revival. Based on a comment he made in a recent Ralph Gleason interview, we asked John Fogerty exactly what he sees.
Besides people looking for your music, they also, well, they want to know what you think. They want to know what you wear and, you know, what movies you like and do you eat spaghetti for breakfast and junk like that. They also want to know how you accept the world you live in. Do you accept it, really? I was on the other side. I was the observer. I was a listener on the radio. I didn't know there were so many behind-the-scenes things happening. But if we can get across the fact that what they see isn't necessarily the truth, perhaps it's, you know, they're seeing on TV or on the radio only that which the guy who is showing it wants you to see. You know, what is the real me? What is the real Richard Nixon? You know, who is Neil Armstrong, really? You know, and if you could get that across, at least to where people are looking to what he's going to say next and questioning it, not just, you know, at face value, was saying, why did he say that? I didn't think people could just say stuff that they didn't mean. I begin to see that things aren't just what they're shown to be. You know, I'm trying now to look behind it consciously.
An interview with nationally syndicated critic and columnist Ralph J. Gleason.
Why is it that you have some portion of this responsibility now instead of, I say, Frank Sinatra didn't?
I don't want it. You know, I never set out to want it, but I can see that it's being given. Mm. Since it is, I want people to know when I'm really saying something seriously and when I'm just being an entertainer, you know. But it's also important that then I don't appeal to basic motivations, that I don't start, you know, hey, all you hippies, join together and let's smoke dope, you know. I mean, people are going to dig that, a certain element of society, but I don't want them digging it for that. I want them to look a little further than just, hey, okay, we're all together, brother, you know, and that crap. Who'll Stop the Rain, and some of the others too, but especially that one, I tried to stay away from, hey, he's a left-wing radical crazy, or he's a super bircher, you know, because both sides can take it, you know, and use it as their own rallying cry. Same as Fortunate Son, really. You know, you can see all the Minutemen, the Birchers saying, wow, the Fortunate Son, yeah, I hate them people too. It's not just a definite everything is this or everything is that.
Thank you.
too important this evening. We want to thank you all for bearing with the whole thing. I love Wilbur, and I love Booker T, and I hope you enjoy some of what we did too. Anyway, here's a song called Keep On Shootin'. Keep on shooting.
Every once in a while, I've only done it a few times, I'll go back outside. Suddenly, it's like, whew, and you just kind of look, and you say, wow, half hour ago, this place was really jumping, you know, and you look around, and it's a silence that's almost, not religious, but it's unbelievable. You can almost still see the walls, you know, shaking, going back and forth, and there's no one there. You know, tomorrow night, it's going to be basketball or the Ice Follies or something, and it's like, it's already, our thing's already finished. It's gone. Those people are out in their car, they're driving home, they're listening to the radio, you know, it's like, sometimes I wonder, hey, it's just like football, you know, no difference. And other times I think, well, these aren't the same people. These are, you know, these are our people. They came for this and nothing else, you know. They won't come back until people like us come back. There's a place up ahead and I'm going just as fast as my feet can fly. Come away, and get going. Leave the sinking ship behind. Come on, the rising wind. We're going up around.
You have just seen a film of a concert of Creedence Clearwater Revival that took place in Oakland, California on January 31st, 1970. Creedence continues on as a trio composed of John Fogerty, Doug Clifford, and Stu Cook. Tom Fogerty is now performing as a solo artist.